May I come in, sir?
Yes, please do.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Please take your seat. Mr. Rahul.
Yes, sir.
Rahul, tell us something about you.
So I belong to Indore, Madhya Pradesh. I have done my graduation in chemical engineering from IIT Bombay. And post that, I have joined Axis Bank as a risk analyst. And then I started preparing for civil services. Last year, I got into Indian Railway Traffic Services. And presently, I am on extraordinary leave from the service.
You're on EOL because you were already appearing in the exam. And
yes, sir. Right.
So this EOL will affect your seniority over there or no?
I don't think so, sir. It is a part, you can take 1 year leave. It is a part of the service, so it is not an issue.
Okay. So Rahul, it means you basically trying only for 3-4 services?
Yes, sir.
May I know the preferences?
Sir, IAS, IPS, Foreign Service and Revenue Service Income Tax.
So these are the 4 services you're trying?
Yes.
Okay. And you're basically from Indore?
Yes, sir.
You studied in IIT Bombay for 5 years, that is B.Tech, M.Tech.
Yes, it was integrated course.
So, don't you think that staying in engineering field, either in academics research or in industry, would have been better than getting into IITS or for that matter even IAS?
Sir, since it was my long-term ambition, it was my childhood dream to join IAS. My father is also in state services. So I have already seen this.
So, बचपन की गलतियाँ कब तक उठाएंगे? You dreamed it because of your parents, but now you have grown up.
Sir, I think I have a deep interest in the service as well, because when I was in IIT Bombay, I was working as a president of my hostel, and at that time, the work I used to do was giving me immense happiness as well as satisfaction. So I think working in these areas where I can help people and can serve people and would help a society as well as will fulfill my needs of satisfaction and happiness. So I think I would be a better fit in this service.
You're from Madhya Pradesh. Recently elections took place in Madhya Pradesh and the incumbent BJP government lost.
Yes.
One of the reasons that is said BJP lost is the farmers' distress. Another reason is said the youth distress.
Yes.
What are the reasons of youth distress? Why youth unemployment has become such a big issue?
So the two issues mentioned, agrarian distress and youth distress, are interlinked actually. Madhya Pradesh is an agrarian economy, and though we have reached very good in terms of production, we are highest in terms of production in various different crops, but that has not turned into jobs because food procurement has been weak. And as well as there is lack of food processing industries. So that is the first issue. The agrarian or the youth in the rural areas is not getting the desired jobs. Secondly, there has been a lot of institutions, a lot of engineering colleges, a lot of medical colleges, etc. in Madhya Pradesh. But unfortunately, there are not many industries. So people are not getting the due jobs and thus they have to migrate. So I think that is another issue why youth is not, there is a youth disenchantment. And this could have led to the, it was an election issue as well.
See, since you're an engineer, you'll be able to appreciate what my hunch is. The fact is that we have a tremendous growth in the tertiary sector. Yes. Manufacturing sector and agrarian sector in any case are shrinking. They will shrink as per the normal growth of, normal pattern of growth is concerned. And the fact is that the tertiary sector cannot actually provide job to all.
Right.
So, are we in for a very long inning of jobless growth world over?
Sir, rightly pointed out, the tertiary sector is growing and maximum jobs are in that area. But definitely we need to focus upon manufacturing because that is where the labor intensive jobs are. So the future pattern to definitely if the trend continues as it is right now, it would be a long term process and there would be jobless growth. Thus, we need to change and we need to go for manufacturing plus services growth led growth. So in that sense, we need to focus on manufacturing, for example, labor intensive sectors, we need to focus upon, as rightly said by economic survey previously as well, and also the service sectors because they provide higher growth, higher jobs, and integration of both the sectors can be a way ahead.
I can see that you prepared a case study on Delhi Metro airport line.
Yes, sir.
Why do you think the PPP failed in Delhi Metro airport line?
Sir, there are multiple issues which led to the failure. First was the ridership estimates were far-fetched. I mean, the ridership estimates which were targeted for first few years are still not reached yet. So that was the first issue. Second was the private concessionaire, that was Reliance Infrastructure, moved out of the project because of civil defaults in the structure. And there was, in the concessionaire agreement, there was no point or there was no mention of the who will bear the maintenance cost. So there was dispute between the private and the public partner, and that led to the failure. And the last one was, I think from the private partner side, there was a fault because there were a lot of avenues provided by the public player or the government for non-fair revenues, which were not targeted. And thus, it was, I think, lack of patience from the side, which led to the failure.
Because you're already in IRTS, this experience from the PPP failure in airport line, do you believe that it is some kind of a warning bell for Indian Railways as well? Because they too are eyeing a similar kind of partnership in many areas.
Yes, sir, as rightly said, that from failures we learn. And the first thing which we need to do is to we need to make our concession agreement very holistic. By holistic, I mean it should it should encompass everything. For example, who will maintain the tracks? What would happen in case the line is closed? What are the penalties, etc.? First is that. Secondly, we need to see the technical bit of the private player. For example, what experience does he have? Does his past experience, whether he has left the line or he has continued working, etc. And as well as we should try to regulate the system in such a way that excessive bidding should not happen. I mean, sometimes private investors in a quest to take the project, bid extra, which is not viable. So we need to look into all these aspects as well. So this is the biggest learning for us in the future.
But government seem to have not learned much because things are being done in Rafael. Inexperienced, similar, same person is actually being given huge contracts as offshoot thing.
Sir, I think these are the two different things because in Rafale, it was not in the prerogative of the government, it was in the prerogative of the private concessionaire, that is Dassault.
Do you honestly believe that?
Sir, as per the...
As per the written reports, I have to believe it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Mr. Jain. So you like Sufi music?
Yes, sir.
Who is your favorite singer in Sufi music?
Sir, there are many, I cannot say one, but...
Name you can take?
Rahat Fateh Ali Khan is one of my favorite singers and... Atif Aslam, I like.
Okay. And Coke Studio song?
Yes, sir.
So, which Coke Studio you like? Pakistan version or Indian version?
Sir, both of them, sir. Pakistan version was a starting one, so my interest developed with that. And now Indian music, Indian Coke Studio songs are also developing to that extent. So both.
Don't you think that it is unjust on the Indian artist part that Pakistani Sufi musicians are coming in India, they're getting a good limelight, earning a lot of money, and then they have a hidden agenda to settle down in India itself. And our own Sufi music fraternity, they're struggling a lot.
Sir, no, I don't think so that because that is also a learning chance for our musicians that they can learn different genres. For example, Sufi music in Pakistan is very established.
They can go there and they can learn it.
So definitely that can also happen. And I think this is happening globally. And this is also a very good model to learn upon. And I think we cannot see this with a myopic eye because music, art, literature, culture brings people together. And this might also lead to diffusion of the existing problems within the countries as well. So we need to see into that light as well.
Okay, fine. You have done chemical engineering, right? And your optional is chemistry.
Yes, sir.
What is plasma state?
So plasma is the fourth state of matter. It is said that for example, we have gaseous state of matter. So when a substance is heated to that extent that the particles inside gets ionized, that it reaches the plasma state of matter.
Okay. Do we find atomic structure in plasma state?
We find ions. So yes, atomic structure can be found. But definitely now, I'm not very sure of it.
Okay. These days, one thing is very much in controversy, that is use of food preservatives and their carcinogenic effect.
Yes.
Can you name a few of them?
So I think in Nestle it was monosodium glutamate, which was a carcinogenic content. And apart from that, there are unfortunate practices going in for terms of food adulteration. So one is Ajinomoto, which is using Chinese food. That is also one of the food.
What is trans fat?
So trans fat, I'm not aware about the exact definition of it, but it is linked to obesity in the people in the country. Trans fat.
Obesity.
Yes, sir.
Okay. You are already there in IRTS, right? So there is a lot of problem going on in Indian railway sector, and that is related to unmanned crossing.
Yes, sir.
So can you suggest some ways to deal with that?
So first of all, we need to provide manned crossing as is, under the government project of Setu Bharatam. It is happening. It would be done by the next financial year, mm-hmm. as stated by the government. Secondly, we need the issue is of lack of infrastructure in terms of there is no fencing around the railway tracks, which leads to a lot of accidents. So fencing around the railway tracks is another thing which we need to do. And apart from that, unmanned level crossings along with man-animal conflict is also creating an issue which is also considered into this aspect.
Okay.
So definitely we need to invite new technologies. For example, certain sounds are railways presently trying out new technology like B sounds, etc. to take keep elephants away from the tracks when a train is approaching.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely this can be
recently used. Railway is also, having a contact with the ISRO to explore some technological option to monitor the railway on the track.
Yes, sir.
And unmanned crossings. Are you aware of that?
So I have read of it, but I'm not fully aware of it.
Okay. What is RailTel?
Sorry, sir.
RailTel.
Sir.
RailTel.
So it looks like a telephone line, but I am not aware of it.
Okay.
About.
Are you aware of concept of bio toilets?
Yes, sir.
Why railway has adopted this bio toilet?
Sir, the first issue was the fecal matter, the excreta was falling on the track. So that was definitely unhygienic practice.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea was to treat the waste within the train, within the railway system itself. So for that, under the Swachh Bharat mission also, this project was undertaken. So
is what a primary goal or secondary?
So it is the primary goal was to keep the tracks clean. And so as to remove the unhygienic practice of excreta on the railways. Along with Swachh Bharat mission, it took a main...
It has to do with rusting of the track also?
Yes, sir. It also has to do with rusting of the track.
Okay, fine.
Rahul, you belong to Madhya Pradesh.
Yes, ma'am.
Madhya Pradesh, recently farm loan waiver scheme was announced.
Yes, ma'am.
Right? How much do you agree with the scheme?
Ma'am, I think it is a very short-term suboptimal solution. I mean, for certain circumstances, we need, in terms of agrarian stress, it is an emergency situation. But it is not a long-term solution because it might not lead to cure the remedy of the situation.
So what exactly is the cure?
Well, the cure is, first of all, we need to identify what is the problem lying in our supply chain. For example, in case of Madhya Pradesh, in my humble opinion, I think the issue is lack of procurement, proper procurement of the goods. So that is one issue which needs to be done. So for that, we need to have a market linkage. We need to promote exports. We need to diversify our crop basket. As well as we need to provide them, for example, e-naam is another project.
But see, we brought in APMC Act, and later on the same act is somehow facing, so you know, the APMC, whatever we did under the act, that is also facing so many difficulties now. People are criticizing that even this APMC, these committees are actually resulting in more farmers are protesting against the same. So what is the solution? If we do something, then again there's criticism. If we don't do, then again there's a criticism. What is the way out?
Ma'am, I think the issue lies not in the policy per se, but lies in the implementation of the policy. So I think now whenever we have learned a lesson in this way that from now on, whenever we start thinking about the policy, we need to think about the issue, the implication or the how to implement it, how are the challenges in terms of implementation. So I think this could be done. Apart from this, APMC in its model, when it was started, was a very novel idea, as it was to provide a holistic uniform market around the states as well as to the mandis. Now, I think with the time, as we say, our production has increased, so export has to be done. So I think time-bound amendment into the act is also a way ahead.
Okay. You belong to Indore.
Yes.
There's a very famous ruler from Indore. Who is she?
Famous?
King, Lady King.
Yes, Ahilyabai Holkar.
Ahilyabai Holkar. So, whenever we talk of history, now our movie is also just turned out, Mani Karnika on
yes,
Jhansi. So, why Devi Ahilyabai is not that much, you know, renowned in history for that matter? Whenever we talk of women rulers, good rulers of India, we all, the Rani Lakshmibai name comes just to everybody's mind, but not many people know about Ahilyabai ji. Why is it so?
Ma'am, actually, I would like to disagree a bit on this because in the area of Indore, definitely she is very famous. However, I agree to the fact that at the national level, the name is not so much. I particularly think because, ma'am, there are some watershed moments in the history of the country
mm-hmm.
where whether females or the male say, rulers have shown a very great leadership and a valor. So I think that has to be pointed out. However, on the other side, I think It is from the
what she actually did. Why she's so, she's very much famous for her administration too.
Yes, sir.
So what were the, give me three features from her administration.
My first was her governance. She was very close to the people. She was available at all time to the people.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, she was known for its foreign diplomacy, for a temple diplomacy. For example, even from Nepal to the coastal areas of Goa, we find temples in which Ahilya Bai Holkar had a prominent role. So that was second. And third was her rule of law and administration. Even it has been, the stories are that even she gave prison to her son for breaking the law. So it was rule of law was also there.
Okay. You were a hostel secretary too.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. So don't you think it is right time for us to do away with gender exclusive hostels? Like boys and girls, why are we having separate hostels now, even in IITs or IIMs, or be it any institute of repute? Now, we are beginning to, we are almost into a co-educational age. So, why can't we do away with this practice?
We can definitely do away with this practice, but we need to understand that there are different infrastructure required for male and female hostels. A security, adequate safety and security has to be provided. So if all these things can be addressed, definitely we can go ahead with these issues. And I think a change is coming, ma'am. For example, in IIT Bombay, a girl is allowed in men's hostel from morning 7 to 10:30 and vice versa for the men in the women's hostel. So I think, and similarly in IIM Ahmedabad, this change is coming. So I think with the time, definitely this would come. However, the society also needs to get ready for that. So I think it cannot be in one go, but in a phase-based manner.
Okay, my last question to you. Suppose you're in charge of railway traffic in a certain area, and you just get the information that certain people are watching a mela or a fair, and incidentally the train route cannot be altered at the last point, so there is going to be a mishap. Either you risk the lives of passengers who are traveling in the train by immediately stopping or whatever, and otherwise you have to, the train has to follow the same path and a certain number of people will be killed. What decision will you take in such scenario?
Ma'am,
the same thing actually happened.
Yes, Amritsar incident. Ma'am.
Yes.
So am I the locomotive driver here?
Presume you are.
I think I would have gone the way the driver has gone to go ahead, because there are two issues. First of all, the safety of the passenger is the primary concern of the railways.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, since it cannot be averted, if we would have stopped the train or I would have stopped the train at the same place, it might have led to the death of the passenger, because the agitating crowd or the mob would have taken into violence route. So I think I would have taken the train away if I am not given a via media approach.
Okay, thank you.
Rahul, what are the potential benefits of privatization of railways?
First of all, would be the experience and the efficiency in terms of management, in terms of work culture, etc. would come into picture. Secondly, the investment, the finance would come as well. And thirdly, would be the customer services and the customer satisfaction, as we have seen in Germany, etc., where the railways privatized. So I think these are the three things which would come into.
And why shouldn't we privatize?
So first of all, railways is a huge organization. And the kind of railways, the kind of infrastructure which Indian Railways is maintaining is incomparable with other nations. And we don't have such a big private player to work upon this. Secondly, sir, Indian Railways is a public railway. We still are the favorite public transportation sector because we are cheap. And we provide services or connectivity to the remote areas of the country, which I don't think a private player if he doesn't find a profit would get into this service. And thirdly, the issue is whether this would lead to the development or will eradicate the present situation or present problems of the railways is also to be seen, because the present railway is facing the problem because of lack of infrastructure. And once the dedicated freight corridor or high speed railway comes into the picture, I think we as an organization can definitely work upon these. So I think we can also work as a private organization. So I don't think there is a need to privatize things.
By adopting dynamic fare policy, are we already privatizing customers of railways? That means we are inducing customers to shift to airways.
So it should not be seen with that eye, because dynamic pricing would be a passenger based service, because a person, if he is willing to pay extra, we'll pay, and also we are charging that in the higher economic services.
But many berths are going vacant most of the time.
And that is why it has also been revoked by the government recently, the flexi fare scheme, because around 40% train was going vacant.
Okay. Who was St. Paul?
So St. Paul was Paul the Apostle, is commonly called as. He was the first Christian priest who preached Christianity after the death of Jesus Christ. And he started from Greece and came to Israel and also to the Iran, etc., in the countries. And he was the one who came till the border of India. He didn't came to India, although.
And which apostle came to India?
Sir, I'm not sure of the name.
Okay. Do you believe that Christian missionaries came to India primarily to create conditions for religious conversion or to serve society?
Sir, as per the history, there are both the reasons. Some missionaries came to India to preach Christianity as well as to spread the message of Jesus Christ. And for that, they started missionary schools, education sectors, etc. However, unfortunately, certain missionaries came for conversion. So it is the mixture of both of them.
What are the socio-economic implications of anti-Clause slaughter movement and social emotion which is being generated nowadays?
So first of all, it is creating a huge problem to the farmer, because maintaining a old cow or ill cow who is not giving productivity would be an issue for him. It would be a problem for him. And secondly, it is also turning certain sections of society into vigilantism groups, which is creating distrust and rupturing the social fabric of the country as well. So I think these are the two major issues.
If you are given task to capture this social emotion and channelize it to create job opportunities, how could you do that?
So in the cow vigilant.
Yeah.
So we can create goshalas. Creating a goshala and would provide employment to the people, first of all in terms of constructing the goshala and then for the maintaining it. So that is one thing which can be done.
Would it be economically viable?
So it can be turned economically viable. For example, a single goshala may not be economically viable, but creating a goshala in the terms that along with certain other economic activities can be turned viable. Right now I don't have that correct picture, but it definitely can be.
What is neoliberalism?
So I'm not sure of the exact definition of the neoliberalism.
General meaning?
Sorry, sir.
Okay, what is neocolonialism?
So neocolonialism is earlier the colonialism was direct capture of power or the authority administration by the foreign power of a given country. Neocolonialism is indirect ways, for example, through trade or through people-to-people connection or through cultural connection. For example, westernization is considered as neocolonialism.
Do you think trade protectionism is growing in Western society because their colonial moves have been frustrated by developing countries?
It can be a one way to say that, but on the other side, they are also facing economic issues in their country. So I think more towards because of their economic disparities or economic problems rather than this.
That means their economic growth was based upon exploitation of the new world economies, and which the new world is now aware. So there is resistance against colonial policies and moves.
So their growth was definitely an export-based growth. So yes, it can be said to one direction. But as I said earlier as well, I think in some countries the population is aging. In some countries, it's definitely the growth of Eastern countries have led to a problem, migrants issues. So it is multiple issues which can be said into the.
Okay, thank you.
Rahul, since you are already in IITS, tell me what is Train 18?
So Train 18 is a recent technology in train. It is going to replace the existing Shatabdi trains in the country. And it has very good new features which might be changing or turning around the passenger.
Why has it been renamed?
Sir, I think it was named Bande Bharat Express yesterday. Sir, it's a practice of training and naming the train accordingly. I think Train 18 would have been an odd name, so they tried to name it somewhere.
Okay. Tell me, like, stampedes are very commonplace in railway stations. So what is the basic reason behind it and how it can be addressed?
So first of all, it is lack of infrastructure. What happens in the peak hour, that funneling effect takes place, and that there's a choking points are there in the railways which we need to take care about. Second is about the spread of rumors of fake news at that moment. So we need to create that kind of sensitization awareness as well as counter narratives has to be generated at the same moment. So that is to be taken care about. And third is, because of certain elements, issues of law and order take place amongst, and this could be an issue which
should be. Tell me, like, India's neighborhood first policy, if we say that it is a qualified failure, as our relations with all our neighbors has kind of gone downhill, would you agree?
No, sir, I will not agree to this point, because I think we might have failed to a certain extent, I acknowledge to that part, but we have succeeded a lot as well. Today, every country in the neighborhood, no matter how adverse their parties in power or the opposition parties say about us, but they believe in one thing, that without India they cannot grow. And definitely that
but
is
that
why
has always been the case, more or less. India has been the big brother in South Asia.
So we are big brother as well, we are helping brother, I think. And in terms of SAARC satellite, in terms of individual bilateral relationship, actually, we are
okay, tell me, like, India abides by one China policy, but China, on the other hand, does not even recognize Arunachal as integral part of India. So why is this? Why is India so soft on China?
So India is not soft on China. I think it is our foreign policy to not to interfere in the relationship of the other nation, other sovereign
nation.
But
don't you see a contradiction that we abide by one China policy, we recognize their sensitivities, but they are not doing the same.
So we are known in the nation, in the world, for our ethics. If we will do what they are doing, then it would not be like would not be working in this.
Okay. Like, you come from Indore, yes. And Indore is leading the Swachhta rankings for last 2 years at least. So is Indore doing so well, or are the other cities not doing enough?
So I think Indore is doing very well. And if I can elaborate on this, I think it is collective stakeholders, all stakeholders coming together and working, which is the reason why Indore is doing fairly well.
Okay, recently, like, the Kerala High Court has given one direction on Sabarimala, that people who are actually not devotees, they should not be allowed to go there and prove a point. Do you agree with the Kerala High Court's observation?
So I'm not aware about the exact context in which judgment has been given by, but I don't think this is a right judgment, because I do not agree to this. Because I think in this country, everyone has rights to go until unless there are reasonable restrictions for a movement of a person. So I think.
But hurting other people's religious sentiments, how right is that? Is that also a fundamental right, to hurt others' religious sentiments?
No, sir. There are definitely lines which should not be crossed. But going to some other's religious place, I don't think would hurt one's sentiments.
No, if you're not a devotee and you are just going there and proving a point that, look, we have reached there, and making it viral on the social media, don't you see something wrong?
But sir, I think it is very difficult for administration or for a person or a trust to identify the motive of a person why he is going there. So it is very, I agree to a certain extent that it is wrong for a person if he wants to show something or have a wasted interest, but definitely it is a very difficult task to identify a person as well.
Thank you, sir.
Rahul, you studied from IIT Bombay. Why is it still called IIT Bombay and not IIT Mumbai?
So I think the name in the act is still IIT Bombay. The IIT Act of 1961 mentions it as IIT Bombay, hence the college name is still IIT Bombay.
So what is the point continuing with that? It can be changed by a simple act. It's not constitutional amendment that's required for that.
So I'm not sure about it. I have to look into this.
Okay, just consider a situation that you are in a position to choose some subordinate for you. You are in a selection process and you have choice. Either you can get a very creative employee who is otherwise rebellious. Second choice, another person who is conservative, is not as creative as the other one is, but efficient. And there's another case who's very, very good in terms of efficiency, but is not honest. Whom will you choose?
Sir, I think I'll choose the second one.
That is a very conservative.
The very conservative one, but very efficient one.
So you want bureaucracy to be on track rather than really trying something new?
No, sir, I firmly believe that with proper techniques, with proper training, a person's mindset can be changed to a certain extent, and his attitude can be changed. I think it is all about the work culture, it is all about the training, and it is all about how the colleagues are working. I firmly believe that with my working it, with my the way I work with people in the past, my experiences, I think we can bring a change in the person, but efficiency cannot be compromised and integrity cannot be compromised.
Rahul, you have interacted all five of us.
Yes.
As a chairperson, I just took a vote. And three of us agree that you should be taken. But two of us disagree with that. You should not be taken is their vote. You have to identify which two of us actually made this decision, who don't agree that you are good enough for civil services.
So it is very difficult.
Obviously, you're not given the IAS job for easy things.
Yes. I think sir would have disagreed to a certain point because I was not agreeing to the points there. And I think I am not able to choose the second one, sir. It was very difficult.
It was very nice talking to you. You can leave now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Sit down, Rahul.
Yes.
Okay, Rahul. So, what is your evaluation? How the interview went? What are the areas you still believe that you need to improve upon?
So first of all, I think my knowledge on chemistry and chemical engineering needs to be little improved because I was not giving the right words. And secondly, on situational questions, I was little low. I could have done a better content there or could have better analyzed the situation. And I started well, but I think till the time I went to sir, I think I was not at the best of my time. I was complacent or I was not actually answering. I was in a little hurry. So I think these are the three issues which I felt while giving the interview.
See, I don't know about the last one you mentioned, that whether your energy level went down or you, I didn't notice at least, that is not my observation. Otherwise, I agree to the most of it. But overall, our impression is that you are a very, very good candidate. What was your score last time?
I got 171, sir.
171 is a little lower as compared to your performance today. I don't know what was your performance last year. It should have been, in my opinion, a little higher than that. But you are doing perfect. You're doing almost on all fronts. We generally categorize things like verbal communication, non-verbal communication, but both verbal and non-verbal. Your voice level is good. Your sitting posture is good. Your hand movement is good. Your eye contact is good. By and large, your communication parameters are good. At certain places, it appears that your speed is a little high, but not really much. Maybe 10-15%. So even if you don't change, it's really good. There's hardly any problem. So I don't think there are issues you need to improve upon. Almost on the subject domain knowledge, yes, in chemistry I was expecting a little better, but then it wasn't bad. It wasn't noticeably bad. It was noticeable only for the person from the domain who would be able to find out, okay, you can do better. For others, you were doing perfect. And I hope railways, we asked a few questions, but you can expect even more deeper things over there. So, primarily, you don't have to do much. One thing, kab hai aapka interview?
21st February.
21st February. The only thing you need to do is that you need to ensure that you sustain what you are performing now. And trust me, it's not going to be easy. Normally, people believe that only rising is difficult. Sustaining is equally difficult. And sometimes, when you peak early, there's just one way to go, and that's down. So make sure you sustain your performance, which you have shown today. There are areas which we couldn't ask. I want you to ensure that you have studied enough in Jain philosophy, okay, which we couldn't ask because of paucity of time. You have done enough in tracking things, especially the recent developments in Ladakh tracking, in Uttarakhand tracking, and in Himachal tracking. Okay, these are the areas I want you to ensure that, because we couldn't ask much about it. Otherwise, you are doing well. About this PPP thing, I don't know, since you specifically mentioned a case study, which was okay as far as the Reliance thing is concerned, but that was very evasive when you said the Reliance, in Rafael, Reliance is not the similar thing. But then it's okay. I mean, that's the only answer expected from a candidate.
Is it okay if I didn't mention the name of Reliance? Or I should have said the private concession.
That would have been better. But otherwise, it will take you to the Reliance route, and then obviously it can take you to Rafael.
Okay.
Otherwise, it's really good. So just, ensure that you sustain by revising things, you're not taking too many suggestions after this. Otherwise, dikkat karega.
So am I expected to, know a lot in chemical engineering, chemistry?
Not really. Generally, areas that are related to the current affair, your domain knowledge, which is related to current affairs, is expected from you. So I generally, for the engineering student, what we suggest is that since you have done the AmTech, but even if you had you been just PTech, we generally suggest that, for example, the electrical engineering ke log, तो जो फर्स्ट सेमेस्टर सेकंड सेमेस्टर में जो लोग अदर डिसिप्लिन वाले जो पढ़ते हैं वी जनरली सजेस्ट डू दैट मच दैट इज बेसिक इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग बेसिक मैकेनिकल तो सिमिलरली बेसिक केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग इज समथिंग यू शुड बी डूइंग अदरवाइज आई थिंक एवरीथिंग इज ऑल राइट ठीक है ना ऑल द बेस्ट
थैंक यू सर